Welcome to this web lecture on automatically driving vehicles or self-driving vehicles. My name is Professor Bert van Wee and I'm a professor of transport policy at Delft University of Technology and closely involved in the Dutch Automatic Vehicle Initiative. Recently, newspaper articles about Google developing technologies for automatically driving vehicles fueled the social and scientific debate about those vehicles. I will abbreviate these vehicles as AVs. The focus of the AV debate is generally about the impacts on congestion, travel times, and safety. Ethical issues are discussed way less. This MOOC aims to fuel the debate about these ethical issues. I will first introduce some ethically relevant topics that raise concerns. Secondly, I will show that there are also advantages of such vehicles from an ethical point of view. Thirdly and finally, I will warn for too much conservatism with respect to AVs. Firstly, which are important ethical topics? The first topic is often referred to as the many hands problem, resulting from several actors being linked to each other, and a combination of actors raise concerns. Let us assume an AV causes an accident due to a failing sensor, partly due to bad weather. Then, who is responsible? Is it the driver, or the car manufacturer, or the company providing sensors, or the company providing software, or the dealer doing the vehicle maintenance, or maybe the road authority who allowed the vehicles on the road despite the bad weather? Even if there legally is one actor responsible, that does not mean the others are not involved. Let us assume legally a driver is responsible, as in the current case. I suggest a debate will certainly evolve about responsibility because the driver thinks she did nothing wrong. A second topic is the so-called trolley problem. AVs will face situations in which a choice for alternative accidents needs to be made. What to do if a vehicle coming from the opposite direction is about to cause a crash? And there are two options: a crash with that vehicle or a sudden change of direction hitting a pedestrian. The AV needs to choose and will do this based on the instructions given. From a consequentialist's perspective, hitting and even killing the pedestrian is the preferred option because then only one person will be killed, probably less than the at least two persons in the two vehicles. But from a Kantian perspective, this may be not the preferred option. Note that pedestrians might also adapt their behavior if AVs will get common. I will not discuss this topic. Thirdly, there is a trade-off between travel times, safety, and sustainability. An optimization of the system from these three perspectives does not result in equal outcomes. For example, from a safety perspective, longer times and distances between vehicles may be preferred, but then fuel consumption will increase due to higher air resistance, and the capacity of the road will decrease, resulting in more congestion and longer travel times. Or let us assume AVs can drive at short distances at 160 km per hour without any risks. This would result in short travel times, but higher CO2 and other emissions. And AVs may lead to longer travel distances, not only increasing emissions, but also leading to urban sprawl and more land take and other drawbacks. Of course, in the current system, there are also trade-offs between travel times, safety, and emissions. Fourth, there are financial and related distributional issues. AVs will definitely be more expensive than regular cars. Experts think that prices of AVs will be at least 10,000 euros higher than of comparable normal cars. One can argue this is no problem. Currently, larger cars are also more expensive and safe, and these are allowed on the roads, even though it's mainly the people with higher incomes who can afford these vehicles. But let us assume the road authority allocates road space, for example one lane of a motorway, to AVs, and the road capacity for normal vehicles decreases, resulting in more congestion for normal vehicles. Then it is the high income people who benefit at the cost of people with lower incomes. Fifth, AVs will make car ownership more attractive. The competitive advantage of public transport for many people now is that they can work, read or sleep while traveling, for example by train. But this will become possible with AVs as well, making AVs more attractive than normal cars. A switch from public transport to AVs might be the result, leading to a decrease in public transport services. This decrease will come at the cost of low-income people who cannot afford a car. And because car use is more attractive, people will travel more by car anyway, for example because they accept longer commuting times because they can sleep or work in their car. And this increase in car use will increase energy use, noise and emissions. The sixth and final issue I want to mention is the transition period. Experts think that immediately after the market introduction of AVs, the capacity of roads might decrease, as might safety. This because of failures in the technology and because we still need to learn. But we will learn, and in the future, capacity will increase and safety will improve. In other words, in the first years of introduction, AVs will decrease the performance of the transport system, but due to learning effects, but also due to the increased market penetration of AVs, in the long run, the system will improve. This causes an intertemporal ethical issue. Note that this is not a complete overview of the ethical issues related to AVs. Other ethical issues relate to, for example, data security, responsibility for data exchange and privacy. Now that I presented six ethical issues, an important question is, should the conclusion be that, from an ethical perspective, AVs are an undesired option? I think this is a very risky conclusion. We need to realize there are also ethical benefits. This is the second topic of my presentation. I will mention a few. Firstly, in rural areas, and in some countries also in large urban areas, people without a car or the ability to drive a car face social exclusion because they have poor access to shops, schools, medical and other services and jobs, and other people like relatives and friends. But public transport often is too expensive. Then AVs, maybe shared AVs, can provide an alternative, reducing levels of social exclusion. Secondly, in the long run, AVs may significantly improve safety, not only of the users, but also of non-users, such as people in regular vehicles, pedestrians and cyclists. By the way, an often overlooked safety issue is the decrease of accidents due to drinking or the use of drugs. Thirdly, energy use and emissions may reduce directly due to lower air resistance of AVs and indirectly because people might shift to more fuel efficient cars because it makes no sense to have a very powerful but inefficient car. I now switch to the third and final topic of my presentation. I want to warn for too much conservatism. To illustrate my point, let us assume we currently have AVs only and no normal cars, and somebody would suggest to introduce normal cars and forbid AVs. Looking at the ethical consequences, people will then warn for many problems lower safety levels, also of non-users like pedestrians and cyclists, higher energy consumption and emissions, and an increase of social exclusion levels. I conclude the ethical aspects of AVs are manifold and complex, but there is no reason to a priori conclude that the introduction of AVs is undesired from an ethical perspective. What do you think? Join the discussion. Thank you for watching.